Hi, good morning. So I welcome you all to this batch for May and November 2019 exam. And in this session, we are going to start with CA Final Indirect Taxes. So CA Final Indirect Taxes is paper 8 and it is for 100 marks. It is a compulsory paper for CA Final. So before we start with our actual syllabus, for next 10-15 minutes, let's quickly go through the different things which are there for indirect taxes. Then how we are going to go about it, what are the different things we are going to do in class, and after the class is over, till before your exam or till the exam day, how you are going to cope up with the entire syllabus, everything we are going to discuss now. So the first point of discussion is syllabus. Now indirect taxes syllabus is of 100 marks and it is divided. So if you see the syllabus which is prescribed, it is divided into two parts. GST, that is goods and service tax, 75 marks, and customs and foreign trade policy, 25 marks. So now what I've observed since last year, this is the first year where we have completed the first year, and this is, we can say, the second year of applicability of GST for exam. So May 2019 will be the third exam for which GST is applicable. So I have observed that students study GST only and they ignore customs and foreign trade policy because it is 25 marks. But if you see the syllabus, this customs and foreign trade policy syllabus is comparatively less, and there are higher chances of getting marks in customs and foreign trade policy also. So we should not do. See, anyways, GST is interesting, so you are going to do that because you see that on a day-to-day basis. Maybe in your articleship also, you have dealt with different provisions of GST. But we should not make discrimination for CA Final. And anyways, afterwards also. Afterwards, if you think that, okay, I want to practice in GST, then you can focus on that. But if you are a general practitioner, then you should focus on everything. For exam point of view, we have to consider both. Now, how we are going to divide our syllabus for our class purpose? So it will be divided into three parts. First is GST, which we are going to start today. Then customs and foreign trade policy. And third one is common topics. Now, what is this common topics? So there are certain topics which are common in GST as well as customs. Full form of GST is goods and service tax. So for example, in both cases, there will be assessments. In both cases, in customs also and GST also, there is going to be appeal procedure. So instead of studying all these provisions separately, we have made a separate part itself called as common topics. And we are going to do those things there. Now, common topics I have divided into multiple parts, again chapter wise. So every part will have one issue and we are going to deal that issue regarding GST and customs. So for example, if it is an assessment, so all the assessment under GST will be discussed first and customs. Then we will try to find out what is common and we will highlight what is different. So instead of studying the same point two times in GST and customs, we are going to summarize it together or we are going to study it together. So that was all about syllabus. We are not going to make any discrimination between GST and customs, that you keep in mind. I am going to hammer this because two, three students messaged me for the last exam that, should we do customs or not? Anyways, we will do GST very properly. Out of 75 marks, we will easily score 50-60 marks. So this is your assumption. The type of questions which are asked in GST, if they are complex in your exam, unfortunately, and customs problems are easy, then we will repent afterwards. So doing entire study properly is very, very important. So that is the first thing. You have understood the syllabus and you are understood and we have highlighted a lot that entire syllabus has to be done very properly. Second is notes. So we are going to provide you notes. And for our May and November 2019 exam, there will be four set of main books plus one book for MCQ. So there will be two books on GST, one book on customs and foreign trade policy, and one book on common topics. And plus, since you have MCQs, we are going to provide you a separate MCQ book. Now, you will say that why so many books? Now, till last year, what used to happen? We would provide you a textbook. In the textbook, there would be a lot of problems. And the problems were required to be solved in the notebook. So, there were multiple notebooks. And again, when the students were revising, at that time, they have to keep one notebook and the regular book, the textbook with them. And it becomes very difficult. So, what we have done now, first of all, we have increased the number of problems by almost 2 times. We have covered all the frequently asked FAQs which are issued relating to GST. All the questions are covered in our class. So, you need not do anything else. So, more than 11,000 problems are going to be discussed in class. And for every problem, we have kept space to write the answer. So, it becomes very easy. So, you just pick up one book, start reading it, read the question and answers, and you are done with it. So, no need to have a separate notebook. That's why the volume of pages has increased. Still, you need not worry because we have tried to cover all the concepts and all types of problems which can be asked in exam. So, when we do lot of practice, our exam becomes very easy. Exam paper is like, you just go attempt and you come back. It is so simple. There is no stress at all because we have done lot of revision. Then MCQs. What is MCQ? Multiple choice questions. So, for May and November 2019 exam, you are going to have MCQs. So, currently the weightage of MCQs is 30 marks. Now, whether MCQs will be easier or not, whether the paper will become easy or not, it depends on student to student basis. If you have done 100% very properly, then MCQs based paper will be very easy for you because you know all the concepts. But if you are I will study only this part and that part, and you are going to ignore some part, and if MCQs are asked on that, then it is very difficult for you because MCQs can be asked from any part of the syllabus. If it is a theory question, then what happens? Even if you write something, you keep on writing something relating to the topic, you can score 1 or 2 marks. But in MCQs, if you don't know anything, then you tick any of the, as per what we can say, essay, you pick up one of the answer, then there is a high probability that the answer is wrong. So, for MCQs, now students were demanding that there should be MCQs. Now, students should study also properly for the MCQs. We are going to provide you one book on MCQs which you have to solve on your own, because for MCQs what is required? All the fundamental knowledge or the basics should be very strong. That we are going to do in class. So any type of question is asked in this multiple choice questions, you can easily attempt. So one book along with the answer key will be provided to you, so that you have to solve. So in few months it will be provided, and we will inform you accordingly. Language of teaching. Now, very, very important point, that I am teaching CA final direct and indirect taxes paper 7 and 8 and also international taxation elective paper. So, all these papers are required to be written in English. So, my idea is that if you learn in English, then it is very easy for you to reproduce things in English. So, language of teaching would be 100% in English. So, I won't be speaking any part in Hindi or any of the vernacular languages, because we have to answer the questions in English in exam. So, use of simple English will be made while discussing the concept. Then next point is the revision. Now, our class is over. You have all 5 set of books, a bigger one. And then you will see, think that how I am going to revise afterwards. So, you need not worry. Our notes are designed in such a way that on every point, every question or every concept, there are going to be multiple questions. So, if there is one concept which is consisting of 5-6 lines, then there will be 2-3 problems or 2-3 theoretical cases based on it. So, what I have done, all the concepts will be answered in the form of question and answers. So, when you revise at that time, at the time of first revision, you can read the text, and then afterwards, when you revise for the next time, so you have to revise the text as well as question and answers. Next time onwards, you will see that everything which is there in the text is covered in the question and answers itself. So when you are revising second time, you can just quickly go through the questions and answers or something which you have written in the book. So that becomes very easier. So that is your revision plus every for every exam after the result. Like for example, the first result in 2019 will be declared in the month of January 2019, and second result will be declared in the month of July 2019, or depending on the elections when the result when the exam is conducted. So after the results, we are going to have a revision program on YouTube. That will be pure revision and it won't have any questions and answers. So you can watch those lectures and revise from our notes. So if you attend this class plus you revise from our notes, the questions and answers, and you revise from YouTube, then it will be more than sufficient. Nothing else required to be done other than suggested answers and revision test papers. So that was all about revision. So we are going to have an exhaustive plan which will help you score more and more marks in exam. Last point is queries. Now you might say that, okay, since this class is conducted online or at virtual centers, or if you have purchased video lectures, then how our queries will get resolved? So you can ask me queries on WhatsApp, or we have Telegram, or you can send me an email. And soon we are going to launch our app. So on that app, there is going to be a discussion board. So you can post the queries there and I will try to resolve it as early as possible. So query solving need not be a problem because of this entire virtual world. Now everyone is so connected that if you ask the query now and if I am free, maybe I'll answer immediately, or by the end of the day, I'll surely try to answer. So this was all about CA Final Indirect Taxes, the basic idea. And now today we are going to start with the first part, that is GST. GST is for 75 marks. And so we are going to start the first chapter. Yes, so we are going to start the first chapter, that is Goods and Service Tax Introduction. Now just some basic overview. Now you might have some idea about GST, but I am going to teach you as if you don't have any idea. So we will understand everything from starting, from the basic things to complex thing, everything will be discussed in class. So basically, there are two types of taxes, direct tax and indirect tax. So you have two separate subjects and one elective also relating to taxes. So what is the basic difference between direct tax and indirect tax? What do you think? So why is it direct and why is it indirect? So that we are going to study now. First, I will read this and then we will do some discussion. Taxes are broadly classified into direct and indirect taxes. Direct taxes. A direct tax is a kind of charge which is imposed directly on the taxpayer and paid directly to the government by the persons, juristic or natural, on whom it is imposed. A direct tax is one that cannot be shifted by the taxpayer to someone else. Like for example, income tax is a direct tax. So if I have earned the income, then who has to pay the tax? I have to pay. I cannot shift the burden of that tax to someone else. So direct tax means if the person is earning income, or if the person is having that much income or wealth. Now wealth tax is not there. So only income tax. So if I am having income, then I will be paying tax. I won't be recovering that tax from someone and paying. So I have to pay from my own pocket. That's why it is called as direct tax. Indirect tax. So GST. Now for example, if you have paid the fees for this class, then have you paid GST? Yes. So you check your receipt. You have paid GST. And will you pay GST to government? No. So on the invoice, GST is given and you have given that amount to the person from whom you have purchased these videos or you are attending the lecture. So this GST will be collected from you by us and we are going to pay to government. Means who is liable to pay GST on these charges? I am liable to pay. But whether I am paying from my own pocket? No. I am recovering from someone else and then paying. So that's why it is called as indirect tax. So goods and service tax is an indirect tax. Person paying the tax to government collects the same from the ultimate consumer. Thus, incidence of tax is shifted to other person. All consumers equally bear the burden irrespective of their ability to pay hence it is regressive in nature. Now, why direct tax is progressive and indirect tax is regressive? Now, in income tax, you might have studied the tax rates. So, if the income is below the basic exemption limit, then you are not having, you are not required to pay any tax. So, for example, if a person is earning 10,000 per month, then he is not required to pay any tax because the total income, annual income would be 1,20,000. But if the same person is earning 10 lakhs per month, then he would be required to pay tax and the highest tax rate would be 30%. So, as and when you progress, your income tax increases. But indirect tax, the person who is earning 10,000 rupees per month has to pay the same tax. For example, if the tax rate on certain commodity is 18%, let's say mobile phone, for example, hypothetical example, the tax rate is 18% and the cost of that, price of that mobile phone is 5,000. So, a person who is earning 10,000 rupees per month is also required to pay 18% GST, and a person who is earning 10 lakhs rupees per month, if he wants to purchase that 5,000 rupees worth mobile, then also he has to pay 18%. So, persons with different backgrounds, different economic backgrounds, won't be charged separate rates. It will be same. That's why it is called as regressive in nature. But again, the base, the tax base of indirect tax is wider because most of the people are paying this particular tax. See, even if you are an ultimate consumer and you are not registered, then will you be paying GST? Obviously, yes, because some supplier is collecting that from you. Even if you don't know that whenever you purchase all the commodities, you purchase at MRP, which is maximum retail price, which includes GST. So, on all the, almost all the day-to-day commodities, you are paying GST, even if you don't know, and the supplier is depositing that GST to government. Okay, I'll give you just 1 minute to go through this difference between direct taxes and indirect taxes. So, direct taxes, they are incurred and paid by the same person. So, we have discussed this. And indirect taxes are recovered from some person. Then, direct taxes are levied on income or wealth. Levied means charged. So, what is the thing on which we are going to charge income tax? On the income. Wealth tax is not there. It has been abolished. Then, indirect tax is charged on what? Sale, manufacture, provision of goods. Then, direct tax is collected after the income is earned. So, for example, if you earn salary, so first that salary should be received and then the tax should be paid. So, there is one provision called as TDS, where the person paying to you will be deducting amount and then paying to government. But other than that, the tax has to be paid after the income is earned. Whereas, in case of indirect taxes, it is to be charged and paid at the time of sale or purchase, or a sale or provision of service. So, whenever I am selling you goods, I am selling you pen drive, that time, whatever is the invoice, that on that invoice, I am going to charge GST. So, it's not that you are going to pay first for the pen drive and then afterwards GST. Everything has to be paid together. And examples are given: income tax, wealth tax, and GST, excise and custom. Features of indirect taxes. Now, in exam, no one is going to ask you features of indirect taxes. This is just a brief introduction. So, every point I'll explain you. An important source of revenue. Now, we have discussed that indirect taxes are collected from all the persons. Like, for example, on salt, if there is, or forget salt. Let's say there is a water bottle. And on that, there is GST at 12%. So, any person, irrespective of his income, who is purchasing that bottle, has to pay that tax. So, the supplier need not check what is the type of person, whether he is of which religion or male or female, or what is his income level. That is not concerned. So, that's why indirect taxes have a larger tax base and therefore they are important source of revenue. So, more than 50% of the total revenue is out of the indirect tax. because direct taxes, it is very easy to avoid. If I don't show my income, then I won't be paying income tax. But indirect tax, so anyways, think from my point of view, I am the seller. I'm not required to pay tax. I have to recover from other person and pay. And in GST, there are a lot of things where you can get caught if you don't pay the tax. So again, the person will say, okay, let's pay tax. You have to do the business. So let's pay GST at least. Then tax on commodities and services. Now earlier, there were different taxes on different taxable events. Now what is the tax? What do you mean by taxable event? It means an event due to which the tax becomes payable. Like for example, in case of excise, excise duty was payable on manufacture of goods. Means when something having or if there is some value addition to the raw material, that can be called as manufacture. A new and distinct commodity must come into existence. Means if raw material is, let's say, cotton and final product is cloth, so a new commodity has come into existence and excise duty is payable on or was payable on that. Then in addition to that, on sales, VAT, that is value added tax, or CST, that is central sales tax, was payable. For services, we had service tax separately. So all these taxes were subsumed, and there is now one tax called as GST, that is goods and service tax, which is on goods also and services also, which is commodities and services. Next is shifting of burden. So indirect taxes we already discussed. We can shift the burden, which means if I am the supplier, if I am supplying goods or services, then in that case, I can collect that tax from some other person. So, if I am selling goods, then I will collect it from customer and pay to government. So, the burden is shifted. No perception of direct pinch. Now, I'll read this entire point and then we will discuss. Since value of indirect taxes is generally inbuilt in the price of the commodity, most of the time the taxpayer pays the same without actually knowing that he is paying tax to government. Thus, taxpayer does not perceive a direct pinch while paying indirect tax. So, maybe you are purchasing one toothpaste and you see that, okay, it is 89 rupees. So, you pay that and you don't know, just know that the price is 89. You pay and you are just unaware of the tax. But it has tax. So, maybe it has tax of 10-12 rupees. So, that time you don't say, why should I pay this tax? But when you are paying income tax and if the tax becomes, well, let's say the tax liability increases by 1000 rupees, then you say, oh my god, this has increased, because you directly feel the pinch, because that tax will go as tax from your pocket. Whereas when you are paying tax on that toothpaste, that amount of 10 rupees which is included in the price, you are not paying it as tax, you are paying it as toothpaste. And then you will say, okay, my teeth will be nice and all those things. But out of that 89-90 rupees, 10 rupees is tax, you are not understanding that, because you don't feel the direct pinch. And many a times, whenever there is MRP which is marked on that particular carton, then the tax is not given separately. Then inflationary. Inflation means what? Inflation means price rise. So whenever there is increase in indirect taxes, there will be inflation, that is the price rise. Wider tax base. This already we have discussed. That direct taxes, income tax is paid by very few people, whereas indirect tax will be paid by almost all the people, because most of the persons will be registered under GST. Then promote social welfare. This is important. So under GST, there are different tax rates for different commodities. So tax rates for harmful products such as tobacco products, etc., it will be very high. Now alcoholic liquor is not brought under GST. It will be covered under excise and state excise and VAT only. So, for alcohol, the tax rate or the duty rate is very high. So, because of that, what will happen? People might think that alcohol has become costly and that's why they will stop the consumption, or tobacco products. So, these are called as sin goods. So, people are doing sin. So, this is the interpretation that people are doing sin by these products. So, the tax rates and duty rates are very high. So, this is possible because of the indirect tax structure, where we can recover more tax or higher amount of tax. And So this is generally done in case of things which are addictive. But a person who is addicted, he is not concerned with the amount of tax. He just wants those things. Regressive in nature. This also we discussed. So rich and poor have to pay tax at the same rate. So this might create a wide gap between the rich and poor. So indirect taxes. But again, it is very difficult to charge taxes based on or charge indirect taxes based on the income levels. So what government does? Things which are purchased generally by rich people, they are taxed at a higher rate. Like for example, cosmetics or cars. So they are taxed at higher rate. Whereas essential commodities are taxed at very low rate or sometimes at zero rate also. So that was all about features of indirect tax. Need for GST in India. Now, why there was a urgent need of having goods and service tax in India? So before GST, which were the tax laws? There was excise duty, then VAT, then central sales tax, service tax, and many other tax. Now you might be aware that there is a concept called as input tax credit. Input tax credit means what? Let's say I have purchased a commodity of 100 and the tax on that is 5. I make a value addition and the sale price is 200 and tax on that is 20. Input tax means from the output tax. Now here I am selling for 200, so my output tax is 20, whereas my input tax is 5, so I will be required to pay only 50. This is the concept of input tax credit or input tax, where tax on purchases is allowed as credit. We can reduce it while paying tax on sales. So under earlier law, in many cases this type of credit was not allowed. So I'll read this need for GST in India. Under the old indirect tax structure, various indirect taxes being levied are not necessarily mutually exclusive. When goods are manufactured and sold, both central excise duty and state level VAT are levied. So there were two taxes levied on goods manufactured and sold. Central excise duty, which was collected by central government, and state VAT also. VAT is value added tax. Those SenVAT and SenVAT means excise duty, and state level VAT are essentially value added taxes. Set off of one against the other, the credit of another, is not possible, as SenVAT is central levy and state level VAT is state levy. So let's say on purchases we had paid. Now this entire discussion is relating to pre-GST era. Excise duty was paid 100 and VAT was paid 25. On sales, now the rates were different. Excise duty was 75 and VAT payable was 40. Now excise duty credit was allowed only against excise duty. VAT credit was allowed only against VAT. So here, after reducing 25, 15 was payable. Here, after reducing 75, 25 was carried forward. It was not set off. So this excise duty could not be set off against VAT, because excise duty was the revenue of central government and VAT was the revenue of state government. So credit of one tax could not be allowed, or credit of one duty could not be allowed to be set off against another tax. So that was problem. So this increased the cost of that particular product, because throughout the chain credit was not easily available. Service tax is also value added tax, and credit across service tax and central excise duty is integrated at central level. So excise duty and service tax credit was allowed only against service tax and excise duty, whereas VAT credit was allowed only against VAT. So internally, the credit could not be set off. Despite the introduction of principle of taxation of VAT at central level in the form of SenVAT and at the state level in the form of state VAT, its application has remained piecemeal and fragmented parts on account of following reasons. No SENVAT after manufacturing stage means the credit was allowed only to manufacturer. Credit of excise duty was not allowed to the trader. Non-inclusion of several local levies in state VAT such as luxury tax, entertainment tax, etc. So, in addition to VAT, these taxes were separately charged. Now, when we are discussing, you might feel that should we remember the pre-GST era taxes also? The answer is no. This is only to make you understand that what were the problems and because of which GST has come into picture. Now, if you compare the GST which is existing today compared to the GST which was 1 year back, the scope has increased, the volume has increased. So, institute won't check the provision or won't ask on provisions which were relating to pre-GST era because there are a lot of things, new things which are there in the new GST itself. But we are doing this in-depth discussion so that you understand that how, why there was need of GST. And in this class, when we are doing general discussion, then you should focus only on the discussion. Because even I was a student, and that time whenever our teachers used to discuss all these things, the first thing that would come into my mind that, okay, this is going on very well, but how I am going to reproduce it in exam? So this all storytelling is very interesting. But when it comes to writing papers, something different has to be done. Obviously, we are going to do that in the form of questions and answers. But once the concept is clear, so see, what should be the steps for understanding any subject? First, you have to clear the concept. Then write many things on that, which we are going to do in our class. And after that, revise. So if you just keep on writing or if you just keep on listening, it won't be useful. You have to do both. Understand the concept very well and then do the writing also. So right now, don't keep things in mind that should I remember which credit against VAT, which, no, you need not remember that now. But you have to remember relating to GST. Otherwise, you will say that, okay, no, GST also credit will ignore. No. Okay, so second one done, non-inclusion. Then non-integration of VAT and service tax. So VAT credit was not allowed against service tax and service tax credit was not allowed against VAT. Cascading of taxes on account of levy of non-VAT, non-VATable CST and inclusion of SENVAT in the value of imposing VAT. Now, what do you mean by cascading effect? Now, you have purchased goods of 100, on that tax is 5. You don't get credit of this tax, means this is now your cost. You have not got credit, means this is cost. Then you add 25, the value addition and profit. So, this becomes 130. Then you sell it for to other person for 130. Let's say the tax charged on this is 10, 140. Then the second person also does value addition and it goes on. Now this sale price includes this. So this tax is some part of it is tax on tax. Likewise, since credit is not available, every time any person is taxing the amount, then in that case, there is tax on tax. And that is called as cascading effect. I'll give you one more example so you'll understand better for A and B. So A has purchased the goods for 100 at tax at 10%. So 10 and then profit. So just it is sold. Profit at 10%, that is 121, and then this is sale price and tax at 10% is 21.1. So now how much will be the purchase price for B? It will be 121 plus 12.11. That is 133.1. Then profit at 10%, 13.31. Then sale price 146.41. And tax is 14.641. Okay, this is the basic thing. And this is pre-GST. So, you need not write this. So, now if you see, this included tax of 10%. That is 10. On that, we have calculated tax. So this tax of 12.11 includes some part which is calculated on this tax. Similarly, when we have calculated this tax includes some part on this 12.11 and some part on this 10. So this is called as tax on tax, that is called as cascading effect. And earlier there was CST, that is central sales tax, whose credit was not allowed. So it gets added in the cost, and this amounts to cascading effect. And whenever there is cascading effect, so we are calculating tax on tax, then second stage tax on tax on tax, and it goes on. So because of that, what happens to the cost of the commodity increases. When cost of the commodity increases, it amounts to inflation because the credit was not allowed. Double taxation of a transaction as goods, both goods and services. Like for example, if you remember, if you had gone to restaurant prior to GST, then you are paying service tax also and VAT also. And VAT was paid on full amount and service tax was paid on some amount. So on that some amount, VAT was also paid and service tax was also paid. So there was double taxation for the same transaction. That's why GST was required. So that's why now a new tax has come into existence in July 2017, which is goods and service tax. I'll read now. A comprehensive tax structure covering both goods and services, that is goods and service tax. There is simultaneous introduction of GST at both central and state levels. Now, India has adopted dual GST. What do you mean by dual GST? So, do you pay GST twice? No. So, whatever is the rate of GST, that half of that revenue will go to central government and half of the revenue will go to the state government where the consumption is made. So, for example, let's say you are paying 18% GST on the coaching fees. 9% is the share of central government and balance 9% is the share of state government. So, both the governments, central and state government, are getting revenue out of GST. It would integrate taxes on goods and services for the purpose of set-off relief and will ensure that both the cascading effects of CENVAT and service tax are removed and a continuous chain of set-off from the original producer's point or service provider's point up to the retailer's level or consumer's level is established. So, in GST, what is going to happen? You are going to get credit of tax on purchase. So, there are only few things which are covered under a blocked credit. Block means you are not going to get credit. But that the list of those commodities is very less. Other than that, you are going to get credit of everything which you have purchased. And that tax can be used to set off against the tax on sales. So, it will obviously affect the or it will avoid the cascading effect. In GST regime, the major indirect taxes have been subsumed in the ambit of GST. Now, earlier there were so many taxes, excise, CST, VAT, service tax, etc. Most of those taxes are subsumed. Subsumed means what? They have been integrated into GST, which means now all these taxes are not required to be paid. There was a separate tax on lottery also. So that tax is not required to be paid. Now we have to pay only GST. Features of goods and service tax. Now I'll just read the main points. Tax on value addition. So whatever is the, so for example, I purchase for 100 and I'm selling for 150. So I pay tax on, so assuming that GST is 10%, though there is no such rate, only for understanding purpose we are taking. So 10% is 15 and on purchase is 10. So 10 minus 15 is 5. Which means 5 is 10% of 50. Are you understanding or not? I'll explain once again. You have purchased goods of 100. Tax on that is 10. You are going to sell it for 150. So tax on that is 15. And how much net tax you are going to pay? 15 minus 10, that is 5. I hope you have this is clear up till here. How much is the value addition? You have purchased for 100 and you are selling for 150. So value addition is 50. And 10% of 50 is 5. So you are charging or you are taxing only the value addition. Though this is a very simple example, there can be different versions of this, because the tax on purchase and sales can be different. But again, we are not taxing this purchase again, because you are getting the credit. You are going to tax only the value addition. Burden borne by final consumer. So supplier at every stage, like for example, A, B and C. So A is selling to B. And we will add D also. 100, 150, 200. And we will assume that tax rate is 10%, though there is no tax rate like 10%, but for understanding purpose. So he will tax on sales for A to B is 10, B to C is 15, and this is 20. How much credit will be allowed to Mr. A? Nothing, because he has not made any purchases. Then B to C, now this is output tax for A, so it becomes input tax for B. So net is 5. And C will get credit of 15, which is 5. And how much would be the price paid by D? D will pay 200 plus 20. And now D is the final consumer. He is not paying any amount. So it means that burden of 20 will be on now Mr. D. Have you understood this? So this entire value chain, since one person is paying tax, the other person gets credit. So that amount is nullified. See this. B has paid how much to A? 100 plus 10. But he is getting benefit of 10. C has paid 150. C has paid to B 150 plus 15. But he is getting credit of 10. Then, B is getting credit of 10. C is getting credit of 15. Likewise, D has paid how much to C? 200 plus 20. Are you understanding this or not? I'll explain once again. Anyways, in our subsequent part, we are going to discuss. So here, A is charging 20 to B. So B will pay how much to A? 100 plus 10. But he is going to take credit of 10. Means how much will be net cost? Will be 100 only. Then C is paying how much to B? 150 plus 15. But C is going to get credit of 15. So net cost would be only 150. D is paying how much to C? 200 plus 20. But D is the final consumer, he is not claiming credit. So this burden of 20 will fall on Mr. D. And therefore, he cannot claim credit. So this will become cost. So how much is the net cost to Mr. D? It would be 220. So that is given here. Burden borne by final consumer. The supplier at each stage is permitted to avail credit of GST paid on the purchase of goods and or services and can set off this credit against GST payable on supply of goods and services to be made by him. So credit, have you understood this concept? When you are selling further, so on sales, whatever tax you have charged, from that you can reduce the tax on purchases. So from output tax, you can reduce the input tax, and that is called as the concept of input tax credit. But which person cannot claim this credit? The ultimate consumer, because he is not selling it further. So the burden on GST, so 20 will be charged to Mr. D, but he won't be claiming credit. So in that case, he has to bear the burden of rupees 20. Thus, only the final consumer bears the GST charge by the last supplier in the supply chain with set of benefits at all previous stages. No cascading effect. So we discussed already this, that since we are getting credit of the taxes on purchases, there is no concept of, or there is no tax on tax. Then benefits of GST, creation of unified national market. Okay, now you might have studied or you might have seen that GST is being advertised, or the marketing line which is used is one nation, one tax. Have you seen that? So does that mean that, okay, Audi also will be taxed at the same rate, or food grains will also be taxed at the same rate, or chappal also at the same rate? No. So it is not that one rate, one tax means one rate for all. Certain political parties are saying that if we come to power, we'll make one rate for all the commodities, which is not correct as per economics, because essential things should be taxed at a lower rate, or they should be exempted fully. And the costlier things, or the things which are purchased by the elite crowd, by the rich people, should be taxed at the higher rate. So one nation, one tax means, now prior to GST, every government had a separate VAT law, value added tax. So the so if I want to purchase, for example, a calculator, so there was a separate rate in Maharashtra, separate in Gujarat, separate in Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, and so on. So what people started doing, they started finding out where the tax rates are lower, and they started setting up factories there or selling from there, so that the tax rates are lower. So now every state was having a different tax rate. So this created confusion. When GST came into picture, so even if you purchase a commodity in Maharashtra or in Goa or in Assam, everywhere the rate is going to be same. So now people cannot differentiate, saying, okay, if we set up a factory in this area, then we will get more revenue, or we will get more revenue and lower tax. So this tax related planning, or planning of setting of factories based on tax rates, now won't be there, because now there is a unified market. Unified means one market, that is one rate will be there for a commodity. Even if you purchase let's say oil in Maharashtra or other state, everywhere the tax rate will be same. Audi will be also taxed at same rate in all different states. GST aims to make India a common market with common tax rates and procedures, and removes the economic barriers, thus paving the way for integrated economy at the national level. Again, there was a big issue earlier relating to octroi, and in some states there was a tax called as local body tax, LBT. So what was this octroi? So whenever your goods were being transported from one state to other, you were required to pay this particular tax at a very low rate, but still it was payable. Then if you have traveled on national highways, you might have seen octroi checkpost. So there all these trucks had to go, then there used to be checking and all, and this used to be this used to take lot of time. So if I want to travel, let's say I'm based in Pune and I want to travel to Bangalore, so maximum 12 hours, 15 hours by car I can go. But the same commodity, or same for the same distance, a commodity which is transported through let's say truck would take 5-6 days, because it had to stop at different octroi checkposts, and then there used to be lot of corruption. So because of that, this transportation was very difficult, and again there were different forms required to be filed, and if one form is not there, then the person had to call that person, and all this settlement and all. So it used to be a very much headache for all the manufacturers or persons who are having interstate transactions. Now under GST, everything is simplified. They have introduced a new concept called as e-way bill. We are going to study in our class also, where once a truck starts, a tempo starts from one place, that person who is sending it has to file e-way bill online. E-way means electronic way bill. So that e-way bill has to be filed online, and online everything will be tracked. So first it will be filed online by the person who is sending the goods, that is a consignor, and that form will be updated by the transporter. And so in the officer, the GST officers can track online where the shipments are going. Then in every state, only once this particular e-way bill and that truck will be checked. And that checking will also be done through some devices which are electronic. So immediately it can be cross-checked. The amount or the quantity which is there in the e-way bill and the quantity which is physically present, and it will be very easy for detecting tax evasion. And that will save time also. So if I'm a genuine manufacturer and I don't want to lose out on any revenue, I don't want to escape any taxation, and I've done everything properly, then the transportation will be very smooth. And because of that, one national market will be created. So if you want to purchase something from Tamil Nadu, earlier it used to take 4-5 days. Now it will take 1 or 2 days. If it is through air or if it is through land, then land route, then 3 days maximum. So there won't be any stoppage because of this indirect taxation. Mitigation of ill effects of cascading. This is already done. Elimination of multiple taxes and double taxes. So we are going to study a list of different taxes which have been subsumed under GST. Subsumed means now they are no longer payable, those taxes, and those taxable events now are covered under GST, which means goods and service tax will be payable when such events occur. So I'll read this. GST will subsume majority of existing indirect tax levies, both at central and state level, into one tax, that is GST, which will be leviable uniformly on goods and services. This will make doing business easier, because I don't have a headache that I have to take registration under service tax also, VAT also, then separate returns under VAT, service tax, excise. That is a big headache. So if there is only one tax payable, then I will be maintaining records only as per that law. Then I will be paying only that tax and all the compliances only relating to GST. And we'll also tackle the highly disputed issues relating to double taxation of transaction as both goods and services. So there were multiple issues, especially in restaurant business, food business, where it was considered as goods also and service also. Information technology, software, in all these cases, then works contract, it was very difficult to treat whether it is supply of goods or supply of service. So all these things are now, these problems are resolved when GST has coming to picture. Boost to Make in India initiative. Now due to GST, what has happened that the procedures are simplified. Now you need not take registration at different places. Only one registration will be required and everything is online. No one is required to go to the GST offices for filing returns, and but for assessments it will be required. But other than that, for day-to-day compliances, you are not required to go. So since the compliances have now become simpler, people now can focus on their main core competence. Core competency means the main thing in which they are interested in. Like for example, if my core competency is teaching in tax, and I keep on doing other things like just posting things on Facebook, then doing all marketing, then shooting for lectures, then all these things, but I don't focus on my tax, my main core competency is weak, then all other things will be useless. So whatever efforts I take on other things, that will be of no use. Similarly, for a manufacturer, if his time is wasted only in complying with these compliances, only if a person is coming, my truck has been stuck at that octroi check post, all these things, then he cannot focus on his main core competency. Due to GST, since now procedures have been simplified, this will help in focusing on the, we can say, main activity of that person, and it will boost the Make in India initiative. GST will give a major boost to the Make in India initiative of the Government of India by making goods and services produced in India competitive in the national as well as international market. Now, when I focus on my product, I try to, so see, everyone has only 12 or 13 hours a day for working, or maybe maximum 15 hours, 18 hours. Beyond that, anyone cannot work. So if his focus is now just on the manufacturing or his main activity, he can think over that how the cost will be reduced, or how I can make it more attractive, or how it can be marketed better. So if you focus on that, then obviously your product will become attractive. It will become cheaper, and you would be able to counter the competition also properly. Competition from the domestic players as well as international players. So due to simplification of things, many things become simpler. simpler. So if government takes care that okay, GST procedure will be simple, then I am also relieved that I need not check all these things again and again. Once I do my compliances, then I can focus on my core competence. Though there was during first 1 year, there were a lot of issues in GST and still they are, but these are called as teething issues. So if anything new is started, there are going to be problems, but maybe you just give 2-3 years and all these problems will be resolved. They are now changing the returns also. They are making returns simpler. So once everything becomes simpler, then you can focus on your main business. And buoyancy to the government revenue. GST is expected to bring buoyancy to the government revenue by widening the tax base and improving the taxpayer compliance. Under GST now, goods and services, everything is subsumed. So more and more people are going to get registered under GST. And if you are a GST registered supplier, your weightage in the market, or your what we can say, exact word, weightage in the market, or your status in the market will improve. Because now, since you are a GST registered person, you will be having a GSTIN, that is Goods and Service Tax Identification Number, and your compliance rating and all those things can be checked online. So if you are registered under GST, then person will think, okay, this person is paying taxes properly, so we will enter into contract with such person. And due to this, what will happen? More and more people will enter into GST net, and the tax base will get widened, and obviously the tax revenue will increase. And other benefits. GST is win-win situation for the entire country. It brings benefits to all the stakeholders of industry, government and consumer. It will lower the cost of goods and services, give boost to the economy, and make the products and services globally competitive. So this GST, though there are many problems in implementation, is going to be a very good thing for India. So please don't say that GST is bad for India. Okay. Now, prior to GST, there were different laws. Now, can the government say that, okay, now today we want to enact GST? So, is government having power to do that? No. If government is given such wide power, then everyone will start behaving as per the ruling party will start behaving as per their wish. So, it should not happen. Therefore, our Constitution of India has three lists: Union List, State List, and Concurrent List. So, if you want to implement any law in India, it has to fall under these lists. So, union list means matters which are covered by central government or union government. State list is a matter covered by state government. And third is concurrent list, which are the matters which can be covered by central government as well as state government. So, this power to charge tax has to be given by the parliament, by the constitution. And if this GST is not there in the constitution, then the constitution has to be changed. So who can change the constitution? Can the prime minister change it? No. Can president change it? No. The person who can change is the parliament. So all the members of parliament have to make changes in the constitution. Because now earlier, service tax was a central tax. Means only central government was having authority to collect tax on services. Whereas after GST, central as well as state government is going to collect GST on services. So constitution had not given that power to state government to collect GST. So amendment was required in the Constitution Act or in the Constitution. Then excise duty, some part was required to be collected by central government, and excise duty on few things like alcohol is required to be collected by state government, alcohol by state government, and other things by central government. But now on manufacture or on sale, now even state government is going to collect GST. So therefore, since this was not allowed as per constitution was required to be amended. Constitutional provisions had given separate powers for central and state to impose taxes. The central government levied excise duty on all goods produced or manufactured in India. State levied VAT on once the goods were sold. Services were exclusively taxed by the center. There were state specific levies like entry tax, luxury tax, entertainment tax, lottery and betting tax, local taxes levied by panchayat. To goods imported from outside the country into India, center levied basic custom duty and additional duties of customs together with applicable cesses, if any. Consequently, a constitutional amendment was needed to enable integration of central excise duty, including additional duties of custom, state VAT, CST, and certain state-specific taxes and service tax levied by central into a comprehensive goods and service tax. So different events were being taxed by different governments. Now under GST, both state and central government are going to charge GST. So therefore, there was a need to make amendment in the constitution to allow both the governments to charge GST on all the specified events. So constitutional 101st Amendment Act 2016 was enacted on 8th September 2016. So what was the summary of that Constitution Act? Concurrent means powers to both on parliament and state legislature to make laws governing goods and services. So central government also made, or parliament also made, law relating to GST that was relating to center, means union government, and state legislature also passed laws which were required for state government. Levy of IGST on interstate transactions of goods and services to be levied and collected by central government and apportioned between the union and states in the manner provided by parliament by law as per the recommendation of GST council. So we are going to study today the different types of taxes under GST. So this IGST, that is integrated goods and service tax, is charged on interstate supply. Now if it is intrastate and interstate, intrastate means within the state, interstate means between two states or union territories. So in that case, there will be only one tax, and that tax collected has to be split up between the central government and the states. So that will also be decided by the Constitution Amendment Act. Principles for determining place of supply and when supply takes place in the course of interstate trade or commerce shall be formulated by Parliament by law. So we are going to study separately one important chapter, big chapter with lot of questions, that is place of supply. So where the place of supply is, on the basis of that we are going to treat it, it is whether interstate or intrastate. GST will be levied on supply of goods, all supply of goods or services except alcoholic liquor for human consumption. So now many students who keep on sending me invoices on WhatsApp, that see, we have gone in restaurant and that person has charged me GST also and VAT also. So first of all, he has disclosed that student is drinking alcohol. Because now how the restaurant is going to charge, let's say food, in the bill there is cost for food and services and liquor. So on food, GST will be charged. And on liquor, there is no GST. Liquor is covered under state excise and VAT. So those taxes will be charged. So in one invoice, there will be GST also. And state excise and VAT will also be there. So it means that same event is not taxed twice. Different events are there. First event is supply of food. And second is supply of liquor. So if liquor is purchased, alcoholic liquor is purchased for human consumption, then in that case GST is not payable. It is not part of our GST law also. So if the government thinks that GST has to be imposed on the alcoholic liquor for human consumption, then parliament has to amend the constitution. because constitution has not given the power to governments to collect GST on alcoholic liquor. On following day products, GST shall not be levied till a date to be notified on the recommendations of GST Council. Petroleum crude, high speed diesel, motor spirit commonly known as petrol, natural gas, aviation turbine fuel, and so all these are petroleum products. So can GST be charged on them? Yes. Is parliamentary approval required for that purpose? No. So these products are covered within the ambit of GST, but GST is not imposed on them right now. Right now, different taxes, state excise, central excise and VAT is being imposed on them. So when will GST be imposed? And who will decide when to impose? It will be notified on the recommendations of GST Council. So central government will get recommendation from GST Council. So there is one authority which is set up to take major decisions relating to GST. So that council will take decision that this GST has to be imposed on petroleum products, and that GST council will only make recommendation to central government. Afterwards, central government will decide when the GST has to be levied. So for alcoholic liquor for human consumption, GST can be imposed only if it is allowed by parliament. So parliament has to amend the constitution. But for petroleum products, so alcoholic liquor, parliament, petroleum products, central government will notify on the basis of recommendations of GST Council. Aviation turbine fuel means the fuel which is required for the purpose of aircraft. The union government shall retain the power to levy duties of excise on the aforesaid products besides tobacco and tobacco products manufactured or produced in India. So in case of tobacco and tobacco products, there will be GST also, and there will be central excise also. So now which are the different things which we have studied? Now alcoholic liquor, who will decide? Parliament. Then this petroleum products, it is already within the ambit of GST, but central government will decide on the basis of recommendations of GST Council. And tobacco and tobacco products, it will be charged under central excise also, and it will be taxed under GST also. Central levies to be subsumed means which pre-GST taxes which were levied by central government are subsumed under GST. First, central excise duty and additional excise duty. Then service tax. So this all these taxes were collected by central government, but now these taxes won't be collected. Instead of that, there will be only one tax, which is GST. Then excise duty under Medicinal and Toilet Preparation Act, CVD and special CVD. So this is countervailing duty. This is on customs. So this was equivalent to excise duty and VAT, which is no longer payable. But in customs, we are going to do in-depth discussion that GST is also payable on customs. Central sales tax, surcharges and cesses in so far as they relate to supply of goods and services. So should we remember these taxes which have been subsumed? The answer is yes. Central levies and state levies to be subsumed has to be remembered. State levies to be subsumed. State surcharges and cesses in so far as they relate to supply of goods and services. Entertainment tax, except those levied by local bodies. Now very, very important. Now whenever you purchase any multiplex ticket, pre-GST there was entertainment tax around 40%, 50%. Post-GST, entertainment tax has been subsumed in GST, which means now entertainment tax is not payable. GST is payable on multiplex ticket. There were two types of entertainment taxes. Entertainment tax collected by state government and entertainment tax which was relating to local authority. Local authority means local body. So which entertainment tax has been subsumed? only the entertainment tax charged by state government. Entertainment tax charged by local bodies is not subsumed, which means when you purchase a multiplex ticket, you are going to pay the basic admission fee, then GST and entertainment tax, which is collected by local body. So entertainment tax is not fully subsumed. So write on in the top margin, write down entertainment tax which was levied by state government is subsumed under GST. Such tax payable to local bodies is not subsumed. Such tax payable to local bodies is not subsumed. Therefore, entertainment tax is collected by local bodies. Therefore, entertainment tax is collected by local bodies. Okay, then other than this, which are the taxes which are subsumed? Tax on lottery, betting and gambling. So there was a separate tax which is also now subsumed. Then entry tax, purchase tax, VAT, sales tax, luxury tax and tax on advertisement. So you have to remember this entire list, that which are the central levies and state levies which are subsumed under GST. Dual GST model. India has adopted a dual GST which will be imposed concurrently by central and states. That is, center as well as state will simultaneously tax goods and services. So if the GST rate is 18%, then it means 9% revenue will go to the central government and balance 9% will go to the state government. Center will have the power to tax intrastate sales and tax states will be empowered to tax services. So now all types of events can be taxed by center as well as state. Problem number one. Why was constitutional amendment required? So we will solve this problem. We'll write the answer here and then we will take a break. So we just discussed that why constitutional amendment was required. What was the need? Because certain taxes were allowed to be taxed or charged only by state government and certain by central government. So there was a need that both the government should be allowed to charge the taxes on the same event. So write down. Certain taxes, okay, we are going to write in point form. So first point, write down. Certain taxes could be collected. Certain taxes could be collected only by central government. Only by central government, into bracket, excise duty service tax etc. bracket complete or state government only example VAT luxury tax etc. VAT, luxury tax, etc. Second point. Now, which type of model India has adopted for GST? It is called as dual GST model. Means both all the events will be taxed by both the governments. But now before GST, some events were allowed to be taxed only by central government and some events only by state government. So now it has to be unified. So right on second point, India has adopted dual GST system. That is on supply of goods and services, comma, both central as well as state government. Both central as well as state government can collect tax. Both central and state government can collect tax. Third point. To allow the governments to collect such tax, comma, Constitution was required to be amended. Therefore, Constitution 101 or 101st Amendment Act Constitution 101st Amendment Act 2016 was passed. Have you understood why Constitution was required or constitutional amendment was required for this purpose, for allowing both the governments to charge tax on supply of goods as well as services? So now we will take a break, and after the break we will check up what are the different types of GST or which are the different types of taxes under GST and how credit will be allowed, and we will try to solve few problems also. So let's take a quick break.